Yo, this is Nohan. We are here in Clearwater, Florida, and we're generally trying to learn more about the Kava culture here. We're here at Kava culture, and we have made some friends here, as we've only been here about 3 days, which is pretty wild. And we've learned about this plant, Kava and Kratom, two different plants. They affect the opioid receptors, which to me is worrying, right? I've heard a little bit about Kratom. We have pills in Philadelphia and also in Delaware. But the thing is that there are journal articles. If you Google search about Kratom, you're gonna see a lot of bad sensationalist things, right? So we're here to ask the question, what's really real? What's good? What's not true? We don't know. But we know that there's been a culture here for about 6 years now. Everywhere you look, there's a Kava bar, Kava store, smoke shop that sells Kava. And we want to understand why this explosion has happened in the last 6 years. And, you know, how does it benefit us? Because apparently people come here, they see what it can do and what it could be. They go back to their home state, they open up a shop. Unfortunately, the government is trying to schedule one, this plant, this material. And it sounds like it's actually really great here for the community that is being manipulated by the state to go to rehab over and over and over and using these. If you want to have some sort of information on that, you can check Vice. They've done multiple pieces on this stuff. We're just here to see it from, instead of a bird's eye view, we're on the ground. And I'm not going to say this is guerrilla because I'm just a photographer, right? I'm not a correspondent, you know? If you know, you know.
My name is Nick. My position currently is manager of Vapor Openellis, soon to be owner, and definitely shout out my boy Lawrence over at the Chill Room, Kava Chronicles Volume 2, Adventures of LB2 and Sackboy coming out. Also shout out to my boy Guru over at Maverick Vapes in Clearwater. We got some big things coming, dude. We got some fun stuff coming. Yeah, it's gonna be a great time. Devil should get you. You meet on Tinder. She'll invite you to dinner. And then if you would, she will give you some splinter. She getting under your skin. Like, where the fuck it begin? Oh, boy, shedding out of his skin. You know fuck is a sin. But you do it anyway that she want it. You a little slave now, and boy, do you want it. You fell under the spell, now the hocus and pocus. Can't you tell that it's the end, now Jehovah's and locusts. She tell you everything.
Are there any recommended dosages that you should be trying to stay under? Are there any, medical or like prescription pills that you probably should avoid when you're on Kratom or Kava? Just in general, any safety information you'd like to share with whoever is watching this?
Yeah, absolutely. First and foremost, I would always say if you're on any type of medication, always ask your doctor about this stuff. You know, they're going to know the most on what goes good with what can't be used with Kratom. They're gonna have the answers for that. I definitely wouldn't drink alcohol and Kava. Those two things affect your liver both the same way. You may not feel like it bothers you too much. You may puke your brains out. Either way, internally, it's not good for you.
Renal failure is never usually a good thing.
Yeah, no, it's not fun. It's right. Not fun. That, and as far as dosages goes, everyone's tolerances are different. My motto personally is everything in moderation. Try not to abuse anything. You know, it is used to have fun. It's used recreational, but it also is used to help with mental illness. You know, it can calm the mind. You know, it can help with pain relief. So definitely moderate. You know, I wouldn't overdo anything. If you know you're not feeling well, you know, you should learn your limits, or talk to your doctor definitely if you have any medications that may or may not mix well with it. I wouldn't do alcohol. There's some people that like to drink Kava and alcohol, and it's never a good thing. Even if it makes you feel good, even if it makes the beer or the liquor stronger, it's still internally not good for you, even if it feels okay on the outside. I think that's about it.
All right, bro. It was really nice to interview you on camera, bro.
Yeah.
So this is Sony coming to you on behalf of Sweatpants. We are in St. Petersburg, Florida. And what we're doing here is learning about the Kava Kratom community, really. There's a culture here. Various establishments where people go, they drink, they commune. and it seems to be helping people with their health. More on that later.
Patient, no more convict shit, I'm growing. Most of y'all.
Okay, we're good.
That's good. So can you tell me, kratom, what is it?
So kratom is a cousin of the coffee plant. Mm-hmm. It's a tree that mainly grows in Southeast Asia, and it's predominant. The reason it's well known in the U.S. is because it contains mitragynine, and then roughly 40 to 50 other alkaloids that they're still discovering, which produce some sort of psychoactive properties. Mm-hmm. You can chew the leaf, you can dry it out, powder it. There's a bunch of different uses for it, but it's just a tree in Southeast Asia, and they figured out that the leaves can be used for a bunch of different purposes.
And what are those purposes?
So there's a wide range of benefits and effects. There's a few different types of kratom. So when it comes off the tree and it's dried out, that's considered green vein kratom. Although it really doesn't affect it, it's not so much the vein color that affects it. Mm-hmm. Now, if it's fermented, it turns red. If it's dried, it turns white. Okay. White and green are known more for euphoric and energetic properties. Mm-hmm. Some people say it helps with focal effects. It relieves sort of daily fatigue. Mm-hmm. Whereas red is more known for its pain relief purposes. It is also widely used as a way to get off of opiates because mitragynine is an opiate agonist. Mm-hmm. So it works on the mu receptor without fully binding to it or working on the same pathways that cause respiratory depression. Mm-hmm. But for somebody who's coming off opiates, they can get some relief from withdrawal symptoms. So mainly it got well known for pain relief, but it does have those euphoric and energetic properties depending on the amount you take.
And roughly how long have people been using kratom in the States?
So it's a debated question. There are many people who say that it has been around since the mid-1900s, mid to late 60s and 70s. Mm-hmm. However, there is a grandfather law and they've never been able to prove it. It became popular sometime around 2005 to 2010, slowly started picking up on the Kava bar scene, but then it became widespread in smoke shops and things like that. But mainly in the 2000s when it really picked up use in the U.S.
Now, can you tell me more about the Kava bar scene, how that came about?
So, as much as I don't know the original Kava bar, I believe it was either Bula or Kava Sutra. It started down, I believe, in Palm Beach and then made its way to St. Petersburg. Now, St. Petersburg is the Kava Kratom capital of the world. There's some 200 plus bars in Florida. There's several hundred in the U.S., but it's kind of a hippie scene. They promote themselves as like a sober hangout. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of ex-addicts and kind of a misfit people, but in a good way, you know what I mean? It's a very welcoming, accepting environment. So it just became big in terms of people who are looking to get away from the hardcore alcohol scene and mm-hmm. people getting super drunk and messy. It's mostly, like I said, ex-addicts. So you get a lot of people who are very understanding, very open, and it became a really cool place really fast.
So on the one hand, it's commonly purported to be helpful for addiction. People use mm-hmm. it to get off of opiates.
Yes.
On the other hand, you have people saying that it is addictive and that it's dangerous even. What do you say to those people who say it's dangerous?
It's 100% addictive, right? Mm-hmm. It works on the opiate agonist receptor. Caffeine is addictive. It's a similar alkaloid while not being an opiate agonist. They are cousins in terms of the family tree of plants. But yes, it 100% is addictive. You can absolutely have withdrawal from it depending on the volume and consistency of usage. The withdrawals can be tough. Mm-hmm. However, like I said earlier, it doesn't work on the pathways that cause respiratory depression. Based on what we know now, I can't remember her name, but she was the lead toxicologist in the U.S. for close to a decade, I believe, if not more. And she was one of the people who helped establish that at the federal level. So when we talk about the risks of kratom, most of it revolves around an unsafe industry. Cut products, people taking it with other substances or medications without any sort of doctor consent. And whenever you have a novel substance like that, of course there's going to be an inherent risk factor because people aren't sure what the long-term usage effects are.
Yes.
But much of the stuff they initially said about, toxicology issues with the liver and, those sort of toxicity reports, much of that now, as they're doing studies and trials in like Europe and whatnot, are showing that it's not really as bad as we thought. And I'm not going to make any promises. Nothing is concrete in this industry. But yes, it is overall, I'll say, safe. I mean, you're talking about millions and millions of users, and we have yet to have any conclusive evidence that kratom alone can lead to any sort of death or overdose.
And can you tell me about how the legal system has impacted the industry as a whole?
It's made it a mess. It's made it really, really messy. So that's why even talking about effects, sitting down talking, we can do it. In the industry, I can't, because kratom is not for human consumption. As far as the federal government is concerned, it is a botanical specimen. That is what we sell it as. We are not advising people to take it. We are not telling you to take it for any certain effects. And that's the name of the game. Because they banned it for import for human consumption, and it has now made this really messy industry where, especially at the smoke shop level, it's not a food product, so the FDA doesn't regulate it. So then they get mixed in substances. Now they're using tianeptine in some of these products, which is a synthetic antidepressant. You're getting experimental research chemicals added to products. So you have addictive and potentially dangerous compounds being added because they're not selling it for human consumption. Yes. So you can't say, oh, I'm putting people's lives at risk, because, hey, it's not for human consumption. And that's because the federal government refuses to regulate it on any level. Mm-hmm. It's either Schedule One, ban it and pretend it has no medicinal value, or we're just gonna leave it as a black market that's somehow still kind of legal. And so it allows people all these loopholes to, you know, endanger the health of other individuals.
So if you ruled the world, how would the government treat kratom?
Well, my personal belief has always been that it should be treated as a botanical specimen, or I'm sorry, not a specimen, supplement. However, just because it is still a drug, it is addictive. I think an age limit of 18 is appropriate to some extent. You know, I never advise it for any sort of minor usage. Apologize for that.
Of course.
I don't advise minors take it. Not so much for the health effects, but rather, you know, it's an addictive substance.
Yes.
But otherwise, yeah, I mean, it would be treated like a botanical supplement. You would have regulation in terms of these packages, these facilities, encapsulation. You would have oversight and overview of that kind of stuff while still having it be a fully legal industry. And that way it legitimizes it, it keeps people safe, and it keeps people informed about what they're taking. Because right now, you can't do any sort of recommendations about what the product is.
Mm-hmm. I guess to leave us off, say there is someone interested in kratom, what would you tell them? What would you advise to them?
Well, what I always advise to my friends is give it a shot in a small amount of tea. You know what I mean? Like, just go out, if you go to a Kava or kratom bar, maybe try an 8-ounce of tea. It might, you know, you may find that it helps you with your socialization skills or something, or just gives you some, you know, general benefits. But I don't really recommend people to start just taking it on a day-to-day basis, especially not just raw powder, unless they have a use for it. It has such a wide array of uses that almost anybody can find something to need it for. But again, I see it more as a medicinal, or, you know what I mean? Like, it's something that assists individuals who are lacking in some area. Now, if you find that you want to switch off caffeine and you think that white kratom helps you a lot, more power to you. But with anybody and everybody I talked about kratom, space out your dosing, take it in a tea when you can, know where you're getting it from, make sure you see lab reports, and understand what the product is. Because if you do those things, you mitigate a lot of those risk factors. Even with things like coffee, it's like, if somebody is asking, oh, I could use an energy boost, you don't want to tell them, oh, start drinking a few cups of coffee a day and get addicted to caffeine. No, you say, hey, maybe try some green tea or something, see how that helps your energy levels. But obviously, again, just be cautious, be informed, and then that way it keeps the whole industry in a much cleaner and healthier place.
Yes, awesome, man. Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate you guys asking.
Where can the people find you?
Me personally?
Do you want to be found?
No.
Doesn't want to be found, folks.
No. Well, come to St. Pete and Tampa. There's a ton of amazing creative bars out here. You can find all kinds of stuff online in terms of reliable and researchable vendors. AKA GMP is a really good standardization process for right now. It does verify the cleanliness of the facility, the testing of the product, where it's coming from, and things like that. So try and find those types of vendors, and stop buying it online from gas stations and smoke shops from a no-name brand that you can't find anywhere on the internet. Please.
Amen.
Yeah.
Closing arguments, I guess.
So my name is Jacob Mason. I work with Import in the kratom industry. I've been around the kratom industry for over half a decade now, and really seeing the community at the bottom level and connecting with a bunch of these people and watching this industry grow has been fantastic. And quite frankly, as much as I hate to say it, in some ways I'm happy to be getting out of it just because of how much of a hassle the government has made this. I'll be sticking around and keeping an eye on it and hanging out at Kava Kratom bars, but right now it has just become really difficult with the legality situation of it.
That's a wrap.
Awesome. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, man.
Would you let
best of luck
like
to you guys.
How'd you let them move your hips? I don't mean no disrespect. I just want to love for dead. I swear never make another love song. Yeah, that's what I love till the guns come. Screams for the love in my too loud. Speaking of love, think I'm too proud.
Between the thighs of the world, we read the minds of the girls. We realign with the purpose of giving worth to the worthless. Imperfect,
you,
I'm certain it's worth it. Searching for persons
insecure.
I think when love is perfect, you feel the shift in the
curve. I made it. I made it too.
I'm sick and tired.
So,
we are at Kava Road.
We are at Vapor Road.
Kava Road coming soon.
We are at Vapor Road, one of the first Kava bars we went to and sort of, realized that this Kava movement, grassroots movement, is really something special. I'm here with
Nick.
He is very soon to be the owner of Vapor Road. And we've had an incredible conversation off the camera, and I'm hoping to have another one on camera with you. Do you consent to this recording?
Absolutely.
Perfect. So, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, Nick?
Well, my name is Nick, of course, right? I started working here, it was like 2.5 years now, I think, something like that, 2.5 years. Been coming here for a few years before that. Built a lot of memories in this place, and kind of all started. I was doing personal training, and I'd come up to the Tyrone location on my break and just hang out. And the manager at the time, she kind of made it a joke. She's like, "Oh, you want to work here? We need an employee." And I kind of laughed it off. But I was already sending her exercises and stuff for like sciatica. So I wrote her on Instagram. I was like, "Hey, were you serious about that offer? Because I can move some of my night clients to the morning because I had more morning people." So I was like, I can close the stores if you really need somebody. I'll have, a little more work to fill my time. And it was like 6-8 months later, she wanted to promote me to manager. I came over to this store, started managing the store. And then almost a year to the day, maybe a month early, the owners offered me a deal to take over and run the place for myself.
And how do you feel about that deal?
I feel pretty great about that deal.
So that's amazing, man. It sounds like you're finally free of the labor market.
Yeah. Well, yes and no.
That's true.
At some point, that's the goal. That's the end goal, is to be able to enjoy my free time in my life, because you only got one life here on this earth, man. I don't want to waste it slaving away, So that is the goal, is to eventually get to a point where I can have my own free time.
It sounds like you like working for yourself rather than working for others.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Would you consider yourself an entrepreneur?
Not particularly.
Yeah.
But I always have wanted to work for myself, or not have to do things my own way. Not have to do things the way other people want them. I like to do things the way I like to do them, and I like to also involve other people in that and not just say, I want to do it this way. I like to get everyone's opinion on things, and now I'm in a position where I can take those opinions and put them with my opinions and make something great,
So what are you looking to make?
I'm looking to make the next empire, man. No, I'm starting a cult.
Isn't that funny?
No, but yeah. Man, I'm just looking to make something, a place that I can come and enjoy my time at. Other people, my friends, can enjoy their time at, feel like they're valued, feel like they have a say. That's really the goal, honestly.
Yeah. So just switching gears here, I wanted to know about your experience with the Kava community and how you got into it, other than, getting this position here. What was your first experience with Kava or Kratom, and how did it make you feel?
So my very first experience with Kratom specifically, it wasn't until later I started trying Kava. But my first time, I was with a friend of mine, as actually a vapor road. We went in to get some coils for a vape, and they offered us some kratom, and we wound up getting one, and we split it. We just split one, like I don't even know what size it was at this point. We just split a cup, and I felt great. And I was like, whoa, this is pretty good, you know? Like, I felt talkative, I felt complimentary, you know? I just was in a really good mood, I enjoyed it. And then there was a big gap of time where I kind of didn't go back to it. You know, it just kind of went in and out, and I just continued on with life. And then the day came where, again, I was going into Vapor Road and to get a coil, and I wound up trying a tea again. I remembered, I was like, oh yeah, I did have that before, you know? And I met a guy named Tasso, and me and him just hit it off instantly, man. We were just talking and talking. We talked for hours, and just, they closed early at that store, right? And he's sitting there, he's trying to tell me over and over. I'm just so enveloped in this conversation, I didn't even hear him. The multiple times he tried to tell me that when they close, everyone goes to this store, actually, because this store was the only store open at midnight, till midnight. So he's like, yeah, finally, as the doors are closing, it was like probably like 10:30, 10:40. And he's like, hey, I've been trying to tell you this. And I was just so caught up in the conversation. Wound up coming here. And then from that point on, I just decided I'm just going to come here and wait for everybody to get off. Because then I started meeting the other employees. I started meeting the other regulars. And I just come to this specific location and wait for 10, 10:15, 10:30. And then for those 2 hours from 10 to midnight, like it was amazing, man. Like everyone was here. I got to meet all of my closest friends. And that's kind of where it all started.
You know what my first thought was when I first experienced Kava?
What's that?
How is this legal and how is there no age limit?
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure on the Kava age limit. There is a Kratom age limit. I would assume that Kava would be about the same.
Mm-hmm.
Kratom is currently 18 years old. I think in July, they're actually switching that age to 21.
Yeah.
I would assume that Kava would follow suit. I think they're both on the bill.
Yeah.
Both on the document that is changing them.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually, within a couple of months, it will be 21 and up.
Yeah. I mean, it's really a surprise for me. It seems like this scene has been around for close to 15 years here. And yeah. It's still completely underregulated in this county.
Yeah, big time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And to its detriment, to its benefit, but also to its detriment. You know, it is kind of the Wild West here, and
I get that. I definitely get that vibe. It's interesting that you say that.
Majority of the time, it's used right, and it's respected, but there are certain people that abuse that, you know, and that's unfortunate. I think that's kind of in every aspect of life. You know, you're always going to find someone that's going to manipulate it to financially gain from it. You know, that's kind of the reality of the world we live in. But for the most part, I would say it's pretty respected. You know, most people are part of the community, and they kind of know the benefits of it, you know, because it helps a lot of people. And there's a lot of talk out there how bad Kratom and Kava is.
But there's a lot.
Yeah.
There's a lot of talk. Yes.
Yeah. And if you have a friend that's, you know, almost died from a heroin overdose, and this person has found solace in Kratom and met a bunch of new people, you know, without having to go to an AA meeting, you know, they found a support group of friends that have also been through certain things, and they're on Kratom now instead of, you know, shooting up, you know, and risking their lives. Kratom's not the most wonder drug. It's not, you know, the end all be all, but it is definitely a segue to a better, more quality of life, for sure.
So, do you have any opinions on government regulation in the Kava or Kratom market? Do you think that they are overstepping? Do you think that it should be regulated?
I think there should definitely be some sort of regulations. As far as the government's concerned, maybe. There's been some times where the government has done good things. There's also been some times where the government has not necessarily done good things. Yeah. Yeah, most of the time they are looking for tax. You know, they're just looking for their money, but...
I think our cameraman agrees with you.
Yeah. Yeah. That was an interesting question, yeah.
Yo, I know people don't like being recorded, but I was hoping that I could just get a quick interview about this lore that you're talking about.
Oh, man, bro, fucking... Listen, here's the thing. Some of the lore is, like, really bad.
What's up?
Some of the lore is really bad.
Like, oh, yeah,
It's very...
Do you have some good lore?
Okay, yeah, I'll do the good lore. Fucking...
I mean, if you're doing a documentary on it, it'd probably be good to include it, too, so you get, like, the good and the bad
sides. The good and the bad side. I mean, I'll still tell you whatever.
Yeah.
We'll cover your face.
All right.
All right. So, him. What do you know about the Kava scene here?
Usually when I was growing up, you would hear about places like Bula, Mad Hatters, and those were really the only two places that was around back in the day. But back in the day, that was the one place everyone would go do shit they weren't supposed to. Fucking when you're underage and you hang out with adults who are fucking showing up drunk at a place that's supposed to be a sober community. Places like Mad Hatters was the spot. And man, there's a lot of stories about that place of not so fun things happening there. But right now, it's kind of like reinvented itself so many times now. It's just that Kava bar with that Alice in Wonderland thing going on. And then we have places like Bula, where they're pretty much one of the first people to capitalize on saying they're a sober community and always serving, pretty much being one of the first places to serve Kava and Kratom for everyone to be like going there. They're so established, no matter what they do, they're always gonna have regulars there. And one of the crazier things is that the owner, even, what was it, fucking, what did he do?
The owner of Bula,
he fucking... He copyrighted the word Bula, which is means to good health and to good life, it from the place that Kava is from. So,
which is like, isn't it like Thailand?
It's Fiji and
Fiji,
so Fiji,
yeah.
Like the South Pacific Islands.
Yeah,
pretty much.
Yeah,
different places there. They have ceremonies. There was someone explained to me how fucking like. Kava came from a ritual that they stopped doing a long time ago, and now people just drink it regularly. Over there, they drink it with wine. They mix it with wine. Over here, we found out that you can't really drink it with alcohol, because it's the...
Not the way that Americans drink.
Yeah, not the way that Americans drink. Because it'll fuck up your liver real bad.
So, I've noticed that there seems to be a lot of ceremony between this Kava bar stuff.
Like, yeah.
People drink it in shells.
Yeah, people drink it in shells. We raise our cups, we raise our shells, and we say Bula. And now Bula Cafe, and they have copyrighted that word.
It was really just smart business.
Yeah.
Because now every time someone, like...
Yeah.
Like participates in the ceremony.
But the reality is it's a huge fuck up because it's cultural appropriation.
Yes, it is. Yes, that is cultural appropriation. One could make that case.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm not here to make that case. And I'm not sure that you're saying that either. But this is, I guess you could say it's a rumor that is in the scene.
In the scene. So... That's how people you really feel about those places, though. When you hear about Mad Hatters or Bula, but they're still here because they were here first.
Yeah.
Even with all this stuff that has happened. And then after that came, what was it? Steeps? No. Came Dharma. Dharma is a pretty chill spot. One of the few places that actually seemed legit, where the guy was. The owner at least seems very polite and aware of how he's running his business in that aspect of things, where he respects the culture, he respects what it means to be a sober community in the Kava bar scene in St. Pete, in the Pinellas County in general.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Are you sober?
Yeah.
How long? How many years now?
I thought you meant right now.
Shit. That's a funny fuck up that I've made.
It's a common thing though that people use it for the opioid withdrawal.
Kratom.
Yeah. Like, just because kratom's still like technically an opioid derivative. So it'll give you similar effects, nothing to like the actual opioids, but it helps with just kind of like the leftover like effects of the opioid like epidemic. And then people, like I know someone personally that he like had gotten in a really bad car accident, and then he got addicted to painkillers, and he like pretty much changed into an entirely different person. He didn't like that. He was also struggling with alcohol. It's another big one that people, just because it's a depressant, like people kind of get hooked to these things, number one because they're addictive in themselves, and also just the feeling that you get from it. Kratom and Kava both like bring a sense to calm you down. White Kratom like will bring you more energy and focus and stuff like that. That can help with people that are struggling with like ADHD and stuff like that. So it's just a more like holistic and herbal way to approach different mental health issues and also like physical pain as well. Because a lot of people use it to treat that chronic pain, whether that be arthritis from a car accident or like whatever may have happened to them, if they can't afford, like I know like there was someone who can't like afford like dental care right now, and they drink like 8 double whites a day, which is like a lot of kratom. And there is an argument going on now that people are becoming more addicted to kratom than they would be to other things. So you're basically just swapping out one addiction from the other.
Yeah.
And I think with everything, and like with any like drug or any like mind altering thing, you have to be careful with it. You have to like understand, number one, what you're digesting, what's in it, like the effects that it has on it, the side effects, like long-term side effects, and you have to know what you're getting yourself into.
So I wanted to ask y'all, what do you guys think about the fact that there are journal articles that are linking psychosis and kratom?
Psychosis and what?
Kratom.
Psychosis and kratom. Damn.
Actually, I have a personal story. Basically, my friend took too much kratom and ended up in the mental hospital.
Was there anything else in their system?
I think it was probably a combination of things.
That's
like partying hard.
Yeah.
Sometimes drinking liquor, sometimes taking kratom capsules.
Yeah.
The capsules are like also an issue because you have capsules in the dry powder. People like they start, and like also like there's like edible versions of it too in tablets.
Yeah.
And like people will like just pop those and not understand just how much kratom is going into their system. Like I remember even like when I first started drinking it, like we were just talking about this, where I drank like way too much, and I had started getting like some of like the like just effects from it. It like spiked my anxiety a lot. I was being really overwhelmed. I felt like everything was a lot more intense, and I also had the nausea because you can just like violently throw up from it because basically your body,
especially if you mix it with alcohol,
for sure, right? Yeah. In this case this was just kratom for me, just because I have like never mixed the two together. I'm very careful when it comes to stuff like that, so I never like want to give myself any like adverse side effects, just because I do have like a lot of like anxiety and depression, and I never want to like enhance that or like fuck with it, like to where it's gonna make me have like suicidal tendencies, hallucinations, anything like that.
And there's always the misconception of which is which in the Kava community with new people.
Mm-hmm.
So Kava's from the South Pacific islands. Kratom is the one that's from the Southeast Asia area. That's the tea that you get in just your cups. If this is another test, I might not survive it. Yeah, the devil in the yellow dress. If she tell you up next, you better off hiding. Yeah, the devil in the yellow dress. If this is another test, I might not survive it. Yeah, the devil in the yellow dress. You up next, you better off hiding. So just keep on hiding.
Yeah. So what do we think about all this?
I personally am concerned.
Yeah.
There is a lot of evidence to say that there is liver toxicity with both of these substances, particularly with
kratom.
Kava.
Kava?
Kava is especially toxic to the liver.
Yeah.
Although it doesn't seem to be the case with indigenous peoples in the South Pacific utilizing this plant.
Right. We saw a journal article that was saying that all the toxicity in the liver that you would expect with kava was reversible in most cases.
It is reversible, although there is not a long history of human use that's been documented scientifically. So who's to say that with prolonged use of kava, you would see irreversible liver damage? In fact, that would be my suspicion.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it has to do with the way that people are taking it in these indigenous cultures compared to the way that Americans are using it, because it seems like they've found new ways of using it.
Yes, and I mean, the word of the day is moderation.
Yeah,
the dose makes the poison. And it's important to note that many, many medications will not interact well with kava. In fact, it interferes chemically with the way the liver is able to break down certain medications. So you could see acute toxicity when combined with things like antidepressants. I would suspect pain pills would be a similar situation.
I wouldn't be surprised even if antipsychotics and mood stabilizers are affected by this.
Yeah, man. We'll have more information later. But
hopefully. I mean, we may not have a chance to come back to this. But it's definitely something that you should speak to your doctor about before considering, because not all of these people going to these bars have the same illnesses as you may have. Or they may have different illnesses, and so it really is it's not something that should be banned. I think it helps a lot of people. It helps a lot of people off harder drugs. But the question is the point to transition to no drugs, or is the point to just trade one drug out for another, as that girl said, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's unfortunately oftentimes the case.
But yeah.
Education is key. Harm reduction is key. Speak to your doctor. Research the hell out of it. If you're going to be putting something into your body, research the hell out of it. And start low. You can always take more, but you can't take less.
I think that that's definitely true. And I also question when we tell people, speak to your doctor, because most of the people in the United States, a lot of people don't have insurance. They don't have the ability to speak to doctors that know about their acute history, their specific history, right? And so it could be that someone is drinking too much, right?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they haven't spoken to their doctor about it because they're embarrassed, who knows? And, you know, they decide, okay, well, I want to get off of alcohol. And then they transition to kava. How long are they going to be on kava, or how long are they going to be on kratom before they get a chance to speak to a doctor? By that point, it may be too late. And I think that that's probably the most worrying thing for me, is there's people out here self-medicating. And who is going to speak up for them? Who's going to ask for them? Because they're not going to ask for themselves. And really, the only thing that you can do is be diligent about your own health. I mean, you should be having regular doctor's visits. And, you know, if you don't have the ability to do that, then I understand. You know? It's hard out here in the U.S.
Ultimately, your health is in your own hands, and you should be very careful what goes into your body.
So
don't buy into hype.
So should the government schedule one this stuff?
No. Because there is medicinal benefit. There is true medicinal benefit to weaning yourself off of kratom, using it to replace opiates, both.
Using kava to get off drinking, right? But overall, the goal has to be to stop. It's the same stuff with vapes. The goal should be to stop. The goal should not just be to smoke. You should be, you know, really focused on harm reduction. If you feel the need to keep using it, I understand, and everyone's in a different place in their journey, right? But the goal should be to stop.
Yeah. well said. I mean, to each his own. I can't knock what someone does to get by. I don't know their medical history, how they react to it, you know, because it's truly a plant medicine. But any medicine can be a poison.
Any mind-altering substance is going to have effects on the body. And you can't ignore them, unfortunately.
Some of them are short-term, and you're going to feel it. Like, you're going to be violently ill. Some of them are very long-term, and it's going to be very insidious. So you just have to be mindful of, you know, look at the research out there.
And definitely don't think like, oh, well, I'm transitioning off alcohol. I'll have a little bit of alcohol and a little kratom, you know, or Kava or whatever. Because realistically, you're just going to destroy your liver, and you're going to destroy it way faster than you would have just drinking alcohol. So if you're thinking about mixing it, just keep drinking alcohol. It's even worse to have both of them in your system.
Yeah, you don't want to mix substances in general.
And yeah, I mean, we are not experts. We put together the information that we could find based on the people that we spoke to. I would have liked to hear more on the other side of things, on the anti-kratom, anti-Kava space. But it's really hard to find that in St. Petersburg, that's for sure.
Yeah, they really like this shit.
They really like this shit here. And I think it would be kind of unfortunate for people to overlook something like this. Are we going to open a Kava shop?
Probably not.
This is like so far on the bleeding edge that the government has not even regulated it. And, you know, we've heard stories that, you know, there are high school students in these bars dating the owner of the bar. Just like,
yeah, some shady shit.
Some shady, sketchy shit. And, you know, it goes with every cool community that's popping up, this subculture. Stuff like that happens. And is it possible to completely ignore it? No. But also, does it happen in other subcultures and subgenres? And yeah, of course.
Evil is going to be everywhere.
Evil's everywhere. And this is a really cool community. And with really cool communities comes some really scary shit.
Got to be mindful. You know, we don't want to make you paranoid, but got to be mindful.
Yeah, and I think we started this because, you know, we've had experiences with these things. And we just didn't know what to think. Now, would I use Kava? Sure. Would I use Kratom personally? No. But I do think it works for a lot of people that have pain. Like, serious, serious pain. Red Kratom or fermented Kratom can really help with those things. You know? So the jury's out. I don't know.
Make your own decisions.
Make your own decisions.
And be informed.
Be informed.
This has been Sweatpants, motherfucker.
Kept it sticky in a Stussy pouch, ski mask, bloody cream hoodie, tossing doobies out the window with a hoopty night, black as Paul Mooney at the movies, but the moon was out. Food was always optional, eating nothing but hard punches to that abdominal. Close fist chronicles, soul sniff mama knew. Baggies laying around, peanut shells at a carnival. Stomping clowns, welcome pussy niggas to the robber room. Buckshot will cover whole torso like a Parker do. In a park or two, plotting trying to garner loot. Split it with his big road dog called a Marmaduke. Searching for a shot of truth and found. Couple bucks, bought his cousin's lunch. Another Dutch, stiff collar on the button up. Hood rich while I'm about to run amok. Road to hell paved with cement covered. Trust for drugs, toughen up.
Well, alright.
Okay. That's how you truly feel about it then.
Well, alright.
Okay. That's how you truly feel about it then.